Hello and welcome to part 3 of the MBSE webinar series. In this webinar, we'll follow on from our introduction in part 1 covering the core benefits of model-based systems engineering. And in part 2, where we looked at applying model-based systems engineering using SysML. In part 3 of this series, we will now run over the human as well as the computer interpretation of these models, which includes interpreting the model on a precise human level, the features available for team collaboration within the modeling environment, connectivity of parts in the model, and the ability to trace the source or outcome of these. Then a brief look at applying methodology in the design process. Then we go on to looking at the computer extrapolation of the core model for purposes such as simulation and code generation. And finally, looking at the features used for verification and validation of the model and code. When working in a model-based systems engineering environment using the likes of SysML, you are using consistent and globally defined modeling specifications. These ensure these standards are constantly adhered to across all organizations involved in the design, the development, and the verification, meaning that it is readable and understood universally, as opposed to using organization-centric documentation that, when passed to other organizations to be followed, can be easily misinterpreted. Because of this, a key feature of MBSE, and in particular SysML, is that the details defined in the models are both human and computer interpretable, and hence computer extendable. This is a great leap forward from standard visual PowerPoint and Visio diagrams and text-based design. The details in the SysML model can be computer processed to generate the likes of script for simulation engines as well as programming language code. Behind all of this are the industry-specified modeling principles rather than organization-centric principles. These need to be clearly adhered to regarding the human modeling to ensure human-to-human interaction is correct, but also to ensure human-to-computer interaction is correct when generating out the likes of code, simulation, or exports to other tools like CAD design. With large, complex systems engineering developments, you do need good collaboration between teams. For the in-house collaboration, there are general discussion options like chat, model mail, journals, and reviews. For complex designs, there can be several levels of organizations involved, and this can involve parts of the process being outsourced to contracting organizations. These organizations need only have access to those portions of the model that are relevant to them, not the complete model. Also, they may have their own ongoing separate designs. For this, there are a number of options to use, including using the ProCloud server integration to integrate to external models. This is very useful for single element scenarios like requirements and compliant issues. Using the ProCloud Service Reusable Asset Service, or RAS. This is very useful where model details are needed to be expanded upon by the contractor. This supports cleanly posting portions of the model to the ProCloud server for the contractor to import into their repository, but ensuring the contractor has limited access to that source repository. Using industry standard exchange protocols, although it is best to use the same application for modeling, where there are cases of contractors using alternate modeling applications, there is also the option to export models in the industry standard exchange protocol, that is, XMI and its variations, like MDZIP, EMX, and UML2 formats. What is clearly critical here is the interdependence between layered models used in a design. When systems engineering a complex system or system of systems, it does require a tightly traceable, holistic repository that includes high-level modeling down to the very detailed specific definitions. That is, a tight relationship from that top level to the SysML blocks and parts all the way down to simulations, the generated code, as well as validation and verification. This requires a very layered approach ranging from the abstract concept to the detailed results, from traceability and verification as to the conformance to the original concepts of the design. Connectivity and traceability. Starting with the requirements, we see how these are interrelated both on the requirements level and down through behavioral modeling, like use cases, to deeper levels of details through to, say, a block. The key tools for this include the traceability view, where we see the hierarchical relationships and can select the branches to view. Then there is a relationship matrix view, which gives a precise view of two sets of elements, in this case requirements and use cases. Here you can define relationships on each cell. For creating an impact analysis diagram, you can use the Insert Related Elements option and be selective in the items to include. Then using the diagram layout, get a clear view of any related elements that may be impacted on a change. With detailed design around large-scale systems, there are more layers required on higher levels to ensure that the mission vision is well laid out and traceable throughout the design. When looking at the Venn diagram given for SysML and UML relationships, it is structured on a behavioral versus structural modeling. On rotating this, it gives the structural column on the left and the behavioral column on the right. Then we see a simple set of layers with a flow of steps backwards and forwards down between the two columns, each with a more detailed definition, until we reach, with a combination of these, that final state where we can do simulation and possibly code generation from the structural and behavioral combination. Where the scope of the system or domain model is defined early, this ensures scope creep is kept tightly under control, as well as defining the interdependence on external or environmental factors. These high-level abstractions need to be detailed, but in phased levels, using the likes of mission vision, domain model, requirements, as covered earlier, and definition of the user's goal using use cases and simple behavioral model diagrams. Where the computer interpretation begins to show is further down the levels, in tight usage of the structural and related behavioral models. This involves blocks or IBDs with child behavioral models, including activity, state machines, and sequence or interaction diagrams. With IBDs and parametrics referenced, these can be used in simulations. Of course, when working with Enterprise Architect, there are many different methodologies that can be used, and these can be viewed from different aspects. For instance, looking at the V model, including requirements, architectural design, simulation, and verification. These process layers can all be interactively worked through. Although simulation is only one of many machine interpretations of MBSE models, this is a key feature. There is a broad variety of options for simulation using Enterprise Architect, including simple behavioral model simulation, DMM simulation, executable state machine simulation, SysML mathematical simulation via MATLAB Simulink or Modelica, and behavioral model simulation using MATLAB or Octave calls. The first three of these can be applicable to MBSE, but examples of these are covered in other webinars. In particular, there are numerous examples of the UML behavioral model simulation covered elsewhere. The ones that are more specific to MBSE are SysML mathematical simulation via MATLAB Simulink or Modelica, behavioral model solver simulation using MATLAB or Octave calls. Let's have a brief run over these two options. Enterprise Architect supports the IMG SysFIS specification. This extends SysML. What this provides is a means of adding details to your model to ensure they can generate Simulink or Modelica script and run these as simulation in these applications. There are numerous examples of these simulations available. Let's look at this electronics example for a high and low pass filter commonly used on a sound system. This is defined with a series of blocks that are specializations of a 2-pin signal component. Here we have the high pass filter that uses the equations on the constraints model, which are applied through the parametric model and all being able to be simulated out, giving three sine wave components of different frequencies and different amplitudes, forming a complex wave. This includes graphing a number of signals derived from points of reference in the circuit. Where you want to do simple behavioral model simulations involving complex mathematics, these can be created using state machines or activity diagrams and involve calls to Octave or MATLAB to calculate the math-specific equations. These solvers are not so tightly coupled with SysML block definition diagrams or internal block diagrams, but they can be extremely useful in laying out behaviors with complex math, then running and validating these. For example, Here is a state machine using MATLAB to simulate the power output of a solar array based on the geolocation, the time of year, and the solar panel array size. All these variables are able to be user-defined in a Win32 dialog that prompts for direct user input to the simulation. There are a number of options for getting code generated from the SysML models. These include using the behavioral model code generation, generation, simulation and debugging using the executable state machine code generation, and using the simulation engine to create the likes of MATLAB models that can be generated to code in the external application. The behavioral model code generation supports state machines, interaction diagrams, and activity diagrams. With a behavioral model placed as a child of a block, it can be generated out to code in a variety of languages, including the more popular software languages, as well as the key industry hardware languages. There are a wide range of code generation standards. Some are specific to particular industries, like the ISO 26262 for the automotive industry and the DO178C for aerospace. With the behavioral model code generation and the executable state machine code generation, Enterprise Architect comes supplied with code generation templates for supported languages. For cases where these may need to be specifically tweaked to meet a specific standard, you can use the code generation templates to set your specific style to change what is generated or provide comments in the code. An ongoing part of the design process is verification and validation of the model. Enterprise Architect provides a number of core options for these, including model validation. This supports checking for conformity to the modeling standards, starting with the underlying UML standards. When checking the HSUV model, there was an older SysML standard used pre-SysML 1.5 but retained in this example. Being outdated, this is logged as an issue. On clicking on the entry in the system output, this gives us a visual reference to the port being posted as an error. There are also the basic test creation options for defining verification criteria. These can be tracked for the element in the inspector view and the construct history view, with the option for logging the results of these checks. Generating test cases from use cases. Where there are use case scenarios used in the development, these can be used to generate out test cases. Here is an example of a use case scenario that is generated out to test cases that can be used in model verification processes. Test cases can be generated against any element in the model or defined as separate elements and hence used at any point in the process. Then onto a more code-centric view. There are features for code testing which include XUnit testing and test point testing. Test points are a model-based testing for code features. These are defined in the model against classes or blocks. Then with the code being run from the model, the user has interaction with these points to validate tests set in these. Here we have a C++ application that is compiled from Enterprise Architect and run from the test points window, which contains test points set against the classes and is returning results. The test points can be edited and can contain Boolean conditions for triggering tests. To summarize what we have covered in part 3 of the MBSE series, this included looking into collaboration involving both in-model collaboration as well as model exchanges for collaborating with external teams and contractors, connectivity and traceability, simulation of the engineering models, and model-driven code generation. Then finally, verification and validation of the modeling. Hopefully this three-part series on model-based systems engineering has provided you with more clarity on the benefits of using MBSE over the older document-based processes, as well as a good overview of the use of SysML and SysVis for both MBSE modeling as well as for verification and simulation of the models being defined and engineered.